I feel as though I've been handed a weapon, sent into a room, and told to shoot a stranger. Well, I need some moral context to justify that action.
I like Star Trek. I mean, I don't adore it the same way I do Star Wars, but I enjoy some wagon train to the stars from time to time.
It should start at full dilation. Why has it not begun?
Mainly Next Generation and Deep Space Nine. Though I would cite Star Trek VI, The Undiscovered Country, as my personal favorite Trek film.
My father requested that I open negotiations.
I know your father's the Vulcan ambassador, for heaven's sake.
But you know how I feel about this. They're animals, Jim.
There is an historic opportunity here.
Don't believe them. Don't trust them.
They are dying.
Let them die.
I also enjoy first-person shooters. Naturally, this would be a peanut butter and chocolate situation for me, right? Except, not exactly? Star Trek isn't really about pulse-pounding action and constant combat. With all the talking and attempts at peaceful solutions, this is a franchise that seems like it'd be more at home with the adventure genre. Or maybe a game that has you captaining your own ship. Or possibly some kind of strategy game. Or maybe even an RPG in the vein of Mass Effect. Wait, really? Nobody's done one like that. Huh. Well, anyways, an FPS set in the Star Trek universe would be a tricky thing, most certainly if they decided to keep the Federation as the protagonist. You would need one hell of a good developer in order to even have a chance of... That'll do. Pray tell, what did the mighty Raven Software, creators of Heretic, Hexen, Soldier of Fortune, the best Jedi Knight games, the best Wolverine game, pending Insomniac's upcoming attempt, as well as both the X-Men Legend and Marvel Ultimate Alliance series is... have in mind for Star Trek. Oh, it's a Voyager tie-in. Yay. Don't get me wrong, it's not as if I think Voyager is some trash series that I wish I could undo ever watching. No, that'd be Enterprise.
Well, what are you suggesting? We choose? One species over the other? All I'm saying is that we let nature make the choice. The hell with nature. You're a doctor. You have a moral obligation to help people who are suffering.
I'm also a scientist. And I'm obligated to consider the larger issues.
Hey pal, you just blowing from stupid town?
Star Trek Voyager is just one of those shows that I have never been able to care about. I feel like everyone has at least one of those, right? No matter how much people insist that a TV show is totally worth watching, or however much you may enjoy other parts of the same franchise, you simply cannot muster the tiniest sliver of a fuck to give.
JK, I give so many fucks. Is that the bag? Are all the fucks I give?
It's empty.
So right off the bat, Elite Force's primary selling point is a non-starter for me. Yet there's no way I can sidestep this game and talk about any other Star Trek FPS without starting with the most well-known one. Just be aware that Elite Force was made for fans of Voyager, and I am not one of those. Star Trek Voyager Elite Force was released in September 2000 for PC, 2 months later on Mac, and even got a later PS2 port if you hate yourself enough to play a console port of an FPS from this time. Though each version had a different developer, this was absolutely a Raven Software joint. While they have long since been relegated to COD multiplayer support studio by the demon in corporate form known as Activision, Raven were once the masters of creating brilliant cult classics that I could, and likely will, devote several videos to raving about. Speaking of Activision, guess who published this? I know. I forget too that they were once capable of publishing more than one single solitary franchise over and over again for 18 years straight and counting.
I am inevitable.
The Microsoft buyout isn't going to make this better, by the way. We all need to accept the fact that we're never seeing a digital version of Heretic 2. And that this is in no way reverse psychology on my part. For those unfamiliar with Voyager's premise, but for some reason decided to play a video game tie-in, there's a handy crawl at the start to recap the basics. Still, I'll give the Cliff's Notes. The USS Voyager is stranded in the Delta Quadrant, well over 70,000 light-years away from Earth on a slow voyage home. Aside from being filled with countless numbers of alien species unknown to the Federation, the Delta Quadrant is also home to the Borg, Star Trek's iconic cyborg hive mind bent on assimilating the entire galaxy into its collective. So not exactly the best place to get lost. It's with this danger and many others in mind, exclusively to this game's continuity, mind you, Lieutenant Commander Tuvok oversaw the creation of the Hazard Team. The Hazard Team is a specially chosen and trained elite force, intended to handle jobs that are too difficult, dangerous, or both for traditional away teams. Point to elite force here. Even my seething apathy towards all things Voyager isn't enough to blind me to the fact that this is one of the best possible in-universe justifications for the all-American amounts of pew-pew-blam-blam you'll be doing despite playing as a Starfleet officer. Nothing like being cut off from any potential aid or resupply to make you reevaluate your priorities. At this point in the canon, it's hard to imagine Starfleet giving the green light to what is essentially a military spec ops unit on any of their vessels. Maybe an emergency measure during the Dominion War? Shit, that actually would have been cool as hell. But not as a full-time thing. Voyager is probably the one place where introducing the concept of the Hazard Team makes perfect sense. You play as Ensign Alex Monroe, in your choice of male or female form. A surprising option to be given in a game this old. Let's go with Femro, because Manro is voiced by Reno Romano using the exact same tone he uses as Bruce Wayne in The Batman, and that's all I can think about when he talks.
With all due respect, sir, I don't think procedure would have mattered. There wasn't any way I could have possibly rescued them.
Oh, come on, it'll be fun. And this will give you more time to work on your makeup. Not that you need it.
And honestly, I tend to prefer playing as female characters anyways when I have the choice. The female Ensign Monroe, Alexandria, is played by Devon Raymond, a woman with a shockingly small list of credits to her name. She does a perfectly fine job, so I can only assume that she must have pulled an Avery Brooks and decided that stage acting was more fulfilling. As for the cast, Elite Force has the whole primary cast of Voyager reprising their roles, except for Jerry Ryan, who wasn't available in time before release. This gets fixed in the lazily titled Elite Force Expansion Pack, and since the GOG version includes said expansion out of the gate, there's no point in talking about this any further. I only mentioned it because I just know there would be someone in the comments bringing this up if I didn't. Back on topic, the Voyager cast do their jobs well, I assume. I've seen Voyager episodes, but not enough to deeply analyze the performance quality here. All I can say is that none of them sound like they're phoning it in. The remainder of the voice cast, the ones exclusive to the game, do a decent job as well, even if it is tough for any of them to stand out with the minuscule amount of characterization given to the Hazard Team. Elite Force opens strong with the Hazard Team infiltrating a Borg cube to retrieve the Infinity Modulator, a weapon designed by Seven of Nine to counter the Borg's ability to adapt to any other attacks. Things quickly go south when most of them get captured by the Borg, though, and Monroe decides the best thing to do is to shoot a control console, killing everyone in the vicinity. Wow, this is a short game. I can't believe they had the gall to release this at full price. Nah, just kidding. It was a dream all along. A holodeck simulation. Monroe gets the expected tongue-lashing for acting without thinking, but there isn't much time to think about this because Voyager is under attack for reals this time. Upon returning fire to the probe attacking them, the Voyager is transported to an unknown region of space by the resulting explosion. So, the ship that was already stuck in an unknown region of space is now trapped in a different unknown region of space. Raven, have you ever heard the phrase hat on a hat? This is where Elite Force begins in earnest, with Voyager held prisoner with dozens of other ships inside of a strange ship graveyard. With Hazard Team's help, the crew will have to figure out how to escape their latest conundrum so that they can get back to their normal conundrum of escaping the Delta Quadrant. They'll have to brave the hostile forces trapped here as well, including familiar faces from both Delta and Alpha Quadrants. And by brave, I mean blast them away with an arsenal sizable enough to make the Terran Empire blush. When it comes to presentation, Elite Force is equivalent in its love and attention to detail as Raven's Jedi Knight titles. Everything is designed to immerse the player in the world of Star Trek and being on a Federation ship. So much so, in fact, that rather than release a collection of new missions or a continuation of the story, the expansion pack is centered around its virtual Voyager mode. Here you can explore the whole ship, talk to all your favorite characters from the show, try out some holodeck programs, collect hidden action figures of your teammates, sneak into people's rooms and read their diaries, play a send-up of Mage Slayer, set the Voyager to self-destruct, and even launch the shuttle. Why are you looking at me like I emphasized the wrong thing there? This commitment to compelling presentation was always one of Raven's strong suits. They were one of the earliest studios to really try and push the limits of what you could do with a first-person shooter after Doom caused the genre's popularity to skyrocket. And here you can tell that the dev team had passion to spare when it came to Star Trek. It would have been all too easy for them to slap a Voyager coat of paint onto a generic shooter, but they went the extra mile to ensure that every sound effect, every musical note, every visual, and every bit of dialogue felt accurate to the show. Now if I only found the gameplay all that enjoyable.
You what?
Wait, before you get your torches and pitchforks out, I just want to clarify that I don't in any way think that Elite Force is a bad game. It controls fine, the AI isn't completely brain dead, and all the basic mechanics work correctly. This is a game that does about as much as can be expected of a licensed game from this point in time. The problem is that this is an FPS made by freaking Raven Software. This came out the same year as Soldier of Fortune, but sorely lacks the punch that game had. And I don't mean the gore. Not that a little blood wouldn't have been appreciated. No, I mean both that the weapons lack impact, and that Elite Force never punches you in the teeth when you let your guard down like Soldier of Fortune will. By Raven standards, Elite Force is a very ho-hum game. A ho-hum FPS from Raven is still several steps above most of its contemporaries, but since it doesn't have that extra touch of quality to put it over the top that I've come to expect from their games, yet is too polished to be janky in any fun or charming way, that almost makes the game worse for me. Based on how many people I've seen over the years talk about the multiplayer component, I'd imagine that's where most of the fun is for others. However, I've never been big on competitive multiplayer. And no, it has nothing to do with my brother trouncing me over and over again in Halo. You weren't in the Ghost when it ran me over, therefore you didn't kill me, you dick! So keep in mind that everything I say here relates solely to the single player. Let's start with the positives. First, I enjoy these intermission sections where you can wander around a small section of Voyager before heading to the next mission. There isn't much to do here, and most of the Hazard team seem to want absolutely nothing to do with Monroe when you try to talk to them, but that can be chalked up to the game's limited scope. Second, even if most of them lack the kind of kick that FPS weapons should have, there are some cool designs in here. Special mention goes to the iMod, the weapon you'll be using whenever you run into the Borg, as it's the only weapon in your arsenal they can't adapt to. Not only is it a cool way to have the Borg feature as enemies in your game without having to weaken the game version of them too much, but the iMod is also just a totally badass laser cannon that sounds like you're firing a sci-fi Desert Eagle. Third, this level here where you infiltrate a scavenger base that's made up of several different ship hulls fused together is, as the kids probably say, fucking dope, yo.
How do you do, fellow kids?
It's a hell of a thing smoothly transitioning from the sinister, jagged corridors of a Klingon bird of prey to a... hang on a sec. To a Malon ship more polluted than the entire state of New Jersey, and finally to a damn Mirror Universe Constitution-class ship straight out of the original series. All the while having to keep a low profile as you collect the isodesium that engineering needs to speed up repairs. Plus, it ends with the only tough boss fight in the whole game. Overall, it's the one part of Elite Force that really stuck out to me and gave me hope that the levels afterward would be similarly great. Sadly, it was not to be. The scavenger base wound up being the anomaly, as the rest of the levels in Elite Force are, by and large, long walks down linear hallways, interspersed with the occasional crawl through a Jeffrey's tube or a fight in a slightly more open arena. Not to mention that I made the mistake of picking the medium difficulty like I do with most games. Apparently, Elite Force was tuned for people who have never played an FPS before, because this was the single easiest shooter I have ever played in my life. And I've played Chex Quest! It's better than you think. The vast majority of enemies in Elite Force will either use melee attacks, or fire projectiles so easy to dodge that you'll find yourself dodging shots you didn't even notice. It's what makes the scavengers trickier to deal with since they use the same weapons as you and can be painfully accurate with them. I know, you'd think the Borg would be the biggest threat in the game, but I'm 90% sure I could finish those levels with my eyes closed. Even if you do have trouble with a section, there's no need to worry about going into the next fight on low health or ammo, because there's always healing and ammo refill stations right around the corner. It all comes together to make a very flat experience with one single massive spike in quality.
Oh, yeah, the communications are out. He sent me down here to tell you in person.
Tell us what?
That I'm coming?
I don't think I've seen you before.
Who?
All hands, red alert. There's an intruder disguised as one of us with a woman. They killed the captain. Capture them at all costs.
Before regressing to the mean. Out of curiosity, I tried out the hardest skill level to see how things changed, and it stomped a mud hole in me right quick as higher difficulties usually do. So my guess is that you'll want to go one notch higher than you typically go with difficulty if you wind up playing Elite Force. Trust me, I'm not the kind of guy who often gripes about a game being on the easy side, and yet even I was wishing that I'd picked the hard difficulty instead of medium by the time I'd hit the halfway point. I believe the crux of Elite Force's problems is that it tries to both be faithful to Star Trek and be the same style of action-packed FPS that Raven was known for. Most of the best licensed games in this sort of situation will reach a point where they'll either sacrifice a bit on the gameplay side for a more accurate experience for fans, or accept that it won't always be lore-friendly and focus on fun gameplay above all else. Trying to walk that tightrope of being a great Star Trek game and a great FPS all around leaves Elite Force unable to fully be either. For example, this is one of the rare FPSs where I actually wish there was less shooting and more things to mix up the gameplay. One of the most bizarre realizations for me was while playing the expansion pack. It hit me that you only use a tricorder in Virtual Voyager, one of the most iconic doodads of the franchise, and there isn't even one moment in the base game where you need to use a tricorder. I believe varying things up would have helped the story feel more impactful as well. While it certainly nails the feel of an average episode of 90s Star Trek, that's all it manages to feel like. An average episode. It's so light on meaningful character moments and speeds along at a breakneck pace that it never has the time to get you to care about the other members of Hazard Team. You'll sit through it because it's Star Trek, but you won't remember it after you're done. Certainly not like you would fantastic episodes such as The Measure of a Man.
Your Honor, Starfleet was founded to seek out new life. Well, there it sits. Waiting.
Both parts of Chain of Command.
Ah! Oh! Four nights!
Duet.
Maritza, who was good for nothing but cowering under his bunk and weeping like a woman, who every night covered his ears because he couldn't bear to hear the screaming for mercy of the Bajorans.
Or in the pale moonlight.
Because I can live with it. I can live with it.
Or even like you would the insultingly awful ones like Paradise, The Child, Paradise, Code of Honor, or Paradise. Seriously, no episode of Star Trek has made me as furious as Paradise. A sadistic control freak gets to keep her cult because they've developed Stockholm Syndrome and no longer care about the family that she ripped them from over a decade prior. What a satisfying note to end it on after seeing Sisko be tortured for most of the episode.
This is painful for me too. I want so much to give you water, to let you lie down, to sleep. But I can't.
At the end of the day, Star Trek Voyager Elite Force is a game that I perhaps went in with too high of expectations. Soldier of Fortune and Jedi Knight 2 are two of the best games that Raven ever made, and I'd thrust those sky-high standards onto a game that is at odds with itself. Being based on a series where diplomacy is the first solution is always going to be a tough hurdle for any FPS, and it shows at many points. I credit Raven for being able to pull a solid, if unremarkable by their standards, game out of this head-tilting concept, though. The clear love that the team had for Star Trek on full display in the presentation makes me seriously hope that my opinion is in the minority and others can find enjoyment where I couldn't. In my opinion, though, unless you're a hardcore Star Trek fan who somehow hasn't played this yet, there are far better games from the same developer you could be playing instead. This isn't fun for me, you know? Raven Software is one of my absolute favorite developers. Their games were a big part of my childhood, including the ones I really should not have been playing at that age. And seeing them be shunted into Call of Duty multiplayer support for the past decade by Activision has been heartbreaking. And judging by Microsoft's hands-off approach to Bethesda's incompetence, I don't have a whole lot of hope that the buyout is going to change anything there either. So it's hard for me to bag on a game from them based on a franchise I enjoy. I debated cutting this section altogether and only talking about the other two games, but that would have just left an Elite Force-shaped elephant in the room. It would have been cowardly of me to do that. Like those lazy cheap shots I took at Kingpin in my Sin video that I really regret including. I don't want this channel to turn into another one of those gaming channels that churns out video after video with angry rants about games I hate, and I definitely don't plan on dedicating entire episodes to any game I dislike. Still though, going forward, I'll do my best to explain my issues when I don't enjoy a game if it's relevant to the subject of the video. After all, there's no way I could talk about Elite Force 2 without discussing the original. Speaking of Elite Force 2, Klingon Honor Guard.
You unlock this level with a cheat code known as the Bargain Bin. Inside this level is another dimension, a dimension of bugs, a dimension of glitches, a dimension of pure chaos. You're moving into a land of both ambition and time constraints, of talent and lack thereof. You've crossed over into the Jank Zone. Consider, for your shitposting pleasure, a long-forgotten Star Trek game about the objectively coolest race in the franchise. One of the very first games to be made in the Unreal Engine. A slam dunk if ever there was one. Until, that is, you see the name at the bottom of the box. Microprose.
Released in October of 1998 for Windows and January of 99 for Mac, Star Trek The Next Generation Klingon Honor Guard is exactly what it sounds like, a first-person shooter placing you among the Klingon Empire's elite honor guard that's set around the same time as Next Generation. Likely sometime after the start of Season 5, seeing as how Kern, son of Moog, is your mission control. Excuse me for a second.
Tony Todd is giving me mission briefings! This is the best day of my life!
Sorry about that. Couldn't contain my fanboying. As my terrible Rod Serling impression said, Klingon Honor Guard was published by Microprose and developed internally at their Hunt Valley studios. Now, it isn't as if Microprose had a reputation for putting out bad games by any stretch of the imagination. Quite the opposite, actually. However, they specialized in strategy and simulation games, not action games, and certainly not these newfangled first-person shooters. Damn it! I didn't know the Generations game was part FPS. Oh well, there's always next time. Anyways, you don't expect the company where Sid Meier made his home to put out an FPS on the Unreal Engine the very same year as the original Unreal. That's like Bungie making a real-time strategy game. Bad example. That's like if Yuke's, the developer of 90% of the WWE games made in the past 20 years, made a cutesy game about dogs on an island. Okay, fine. That's like a company called Nude Maker collaborated with, Platinum Games to create a sci-fi strategy RPG hybrid with shipbuilding, published by Sega, and released on the Nintendo DS.
Hi, how are you?
Are you fucking kidding me? The point my examples keep undermining is the developers of Klingon Honor Guard had next to no experience making an FPS, and it shows. While the controls are fine and all the essentials of a good first-person shooter are present, it all gets undermined by strange, confusing choices. Like having nearly all the weapons fire slow-moving projectiles that enemies will dodge like crazy, yet also choosing to starve the player of ammo refills. These stupid drone things are the worst offenders when it comes to making you waste ammo. Sometimes they'll sit there and be shot to death like good little enemies, but other times they'll dodge every shot you fire until you're up close enough that you may as well use your Batleth instead. You'd think then that there would be an increased focus on melee combat, Maybe a couple combos, or at least light and heavy attacks, right? Nope. We're dealing with your standard FPS melee attacks, but with their damage output dialed up to 11. It takes two swings at the most for the Batleth to take out the bulk of enemies. That doesn't mean those same enemies will make it easy for you to bum rush them every time, though. Either I have god-awful aim, or the AI is way more accurate than you with the same weapons.
¿Por qué no los dos?
The disruptor rifle was damn near useless in my hands, yet I always seemed to be getting ripped apart by the enemies wielding it.
As you can see, it's tore up from the floor up.
To say nothing of the grenade launcher spamming dick waffles, or how enemies like to play dead, forcing you to waste extra ammo on a double tap. Then after all that struggle, some enemies won't even register your presence even after you've skewered their buddies. All of this is to say, I actually had a lot of fun with Klingon Honor Guard. It's worse than Elite Force in basically every way, and gets progressively more and more jank the further you get. I had to use no clip more than once to move on in the late game because the way forward refused to open. Yet all the awkwardness gives this game a goofy sort of charm. It feels like they really wanted to make the best shooter they could, but a lack of familiarity with the genre, small budget, time crunch, or all of the above, meant they couldn't get it all shiny and polished up for release. That same passion for Star Trek which Raven showed in Elite Force is here too with Microprose. Every bit of the interface feels properly Klingon-y, with entire levels set inside and outside a bird of prey. They even reference my favorite Star Trek movie by giving the Klingons pink blood.
Hold him! Hold him while I stabilize.
In fact, maybe the M rating played a part in my enjoyment of Klingon Honor Guard. Seeing the blood of various aliens go flying across the screen, and on rare occasions managing to actually jib one, is a rare sight in Star Trek, though very fitting for a game centered on the bloodthirsty Klingons.
Cry havoc! And let's slip the dogs of war!
This is definitely a part of the setting where a brainless shooter feels right at home. Who needs tricorders or, peaceful dialogue when there are Pataks to slaughter and honor to be earned? And, half-naked Andorian women who don't react at all to anything going on. Where's the option to hand her money and tell her, shake it, baby? Duke, Son of Nukem references aside, there are some genuine good points to this game beyond its janky charm. For one, the level design is pretty good, even if there are probably a couple more sewer sections than most people would like. Building the game on the Unreal Engine provided the capacity for much larger levels to emphasize the overcompensating scale of Klingon architecture. Not to mention the impressive spectacle of walking on the outside of a space station or a ship in a game from 98. These are undoubtedly the worst parts of the game, thanks to the jarring movement when using the mag boots and the wonky-ass physics. Fly away now. But still, kudos on the ambition. They also had the basic decency to hide extra ammo and health to encourage exploration. Though some secret areas may not have been too well hidden if an inattentive doofus like me could stumble into so many of them. Now, I've seen people list Klingon Honor Guard as the first game on the Unreal Engine to be released, and... yeah. Unless 1998 was a really weird year and October came before May? I don't think so. Maybe they meant the first third-party title on the Unreal Engine? Legend Entertainment's Wheel of Time wouldn't be released until the next year. And I believe I read somewhere that Legend and Microprose were the only third parties who had access to the Unreal Engine prior to the first Unreal becoming a hit. Not really pertinent info, but I thought it was neat. In addition, there are two, count them, two, ballistic weapons worth a damn here. The Assault Disruptor, a kind of energy shotgun which uses the same dilithium crystal ammo as the much less useful Disruptor Rifle, and when you manage to hit an enemy just right with it, you get this hilarious death animation. Standing! I think it's caused by headshots, but the hitboxes in Klingon Honor Guard are so weird that I'm genuinely not sure if there are headshots in this game, or if some enemies simply have less health than their identical friends. Hell, there could be a hidden critical hit mechanic at play here. You know you're playing an odd duck of an FPS when you have to wonder things like this. The other ballistic weapon is the Sithar Blaster, which at first glance looks like a flamethrower, but... okay, so you were perfectly capable of making a weapon that feels great to use, but you chose to leave this until the last third of the game. Alright, man. It's your game after all. Two of the three explosive weapons are solid, too. A trusty way to clear out clusters of enemies. Though I'd have to question any game post-Quake that couldn't do a decent grenade or rocket launcher. That Quake reference is timely too, as Klingon Honor Guard does the same thing of having the same ammo for both weapons. But since you find so little of it for most of the game, you wind up barely using them for fear of needing it later. You don't. You never need it later. Just use it on these pesky groups of enemies. Every boss in this game is just like a one-on-one in deathmatch. No items, Fox only, final destination. While I'm talking weapons, I should mention the weird way they incorporated alt-fire modes. In a move that I don't recall seeing in any other FPS that I've played, nearly all the weapons require one press to load the alt-fire ammo, I guess, then another press of the same button to fire. In other words, muscle memory will fuck you over several times as you press the right mouse button to fire off a stronger blast, only to start reloading, followed by a panic click of the left mouse button, only to start reloading. The only exceptions to this are the melee weapons, where the alt-fire results in you throwing the blade, the basic holdout disruptor pistol, which will immediately fire the stronger blast, the Sithar blaster, which fires an insta-kill railgun-type blast at the cost of an entire magazine, and the particle dispersal cannon, Klingon Honor Guard's BFG, which you should never, ever use under any circumstance unless you're keen on wasting a massive amount of dilithium crystals. I tried to avoid using alt-fire on everything save for the pistol, which is great for blasting open crates from a safe distance. Why would you need to worry about such a thing and not simply melee those crates instead? Oh, just a bad habit of the occasional batleth swing clipping a batch of ammo like so. You know what? I'm not gonna call that a downside. Have you seen how many things explode in this franchise? Plus, it gives me the opportunity to reference a meme older than Methuselah.
Dilithium crystals hit by Klingon missiles!
That song has been stuck in my head for most of my life. Besides some Futurama bits, it's all I can think about when I think of the original series.
Botan torpedo!
Old games, stale memes, and cartoon clips.
The Master of Evil, the Prince of Destruction, the Dark Lord!
Shuckles, the Silly Piggy!
That's the Swanee the Mike difference. I just realized that I've gone this long without actually explaining much of the premise of Klingon Honor Guard, aside from the fact that you play as a Klingon and guard honorably. Or do you guard the honor itself? Klingons are obsessed enough with honor that I could seriously buy them having a contingent of soldiers whose sole purpose is to guard the concept of honor itself. But your purpose as a member of the Honor Guard is to protect the Klingon Emperor, which the Empire hasn't had for centuries at this point. So instead, your job is to protect the Klingon High Council, currently led by Crazy Eyes McGee. Gowron, son of Morel. One of my favorite recurring Klingons on TNG and DS9. Sadly, no mission briefings featuring Robert O'Reilly chewing the scenery.
You will die slowly. Duras.
In fact, there's a significant lack of Gowron in this game, if you ask me. Back on point, similar to Elite Force, you're given the choice of a male or female Honor Guard candidate, I called mine Kaplana, taking the final exam to join the Honor Guard. Though the difference is even smaller than in Elite Force, since your character has no lines outside of a few repeated phrases during gameplay, it's still nice to be given a choice. No matter how you approach this first level, the holodeck simulation is cut short when the High Council's chambers are attacked by an unknown group of traitors attempting to assassinate High Chancellor Gowron. As a brand new member of the Guard, Kern, son of Moog, enlists you in helping him track down those responsible for the attempted assassination. Well, let's see. This is a Next Generation tie-in, and Barbara March and Gwyneth Walsh are listed in the cast. I think it's safe to say the Duras sisters had something to do with this.
7 hours later.
But note this. The conspiracy runs deeper than you realize. The Duras sisters, Lursa and Beator.
Oh. That was supposed to be a big reveal. Considering how often they're involved in plots against the Empire, you'd think that Kern would have put the Duras sisters at the top of his suspect list. Or maybe he did and I forgot. Even Tony Todd's awesome sauce can't disguise the fact that the plot is only present enough to provide a basic frame for what you're supposed to do in each level. There are a couple times where Klingon Honor Guard tries to do real-time cutscenes after boss fights, but, I think these may have been pretty low on the priority list for the dev team.
Holy shit!
There's also an amusing bug that happens if you're using the stealth suit item when one of these scenes is supposed to trigger. The game will lock you in place, but the boss will keep on attacking you instead of initiating their dialogue. It took me a few tries on this boss before I figured out what was wrong. I can only assume that the necessary trigger is tied to the boss's ability to see the player. Again though, this is one of those jank moments that made me laugh rather than frustrated. It's tough to nail down exactly why I find this game so endearing when Klingon Honor Guard is plainly not all that great of a game. I'm not even sure if I can call it good. There's no question that Elite Force is far superior from a design perspective, and yet I had more fun with this janky mess of a shooter. Maybe it's the M rating, maybe it's my preference for more open levels, maybe it's because I had lower expectations going into this one, or maybe it's a combination of all three. For all I know, I could be suffering from a rare brain disease that makes me enjoy janky video games. Whatever the case may be, Klingon Honor Guard is a mess, but it's a fun mess. The gaming equivalent of movies like Doll Man and Split Second. Something where you can tell right away that things did not go the way it went in the creators' heads, but at the same time, everyone involved gave it their all regardless. The end result won't win any awards, nor should it. However, hasn't there been a 6 out of 10 game like this that hit the spot more for you than better games ever could? A licensed game with an identity crisis. Not great. Not awful. A game too fun for the strange red swan man to call truly mediocre, yet too much of a mess to properly praise. Denied an affordable digital release, the fate of Star Trek The Next Generation Klingon Honor Guard, to be trapped eternally in the Jank Zone. Well, that was fucking weird. Was that my attempt at testing the waters for a new gimmick? What's next? Fanlation fun? ROM hack rumble? Retro wrestling? Videos about games where I'm not the target audience like this cute horsey game? Comment below and let me know which one you'd like to see. In the meantime, it's time for me to finally talk about our main event, Elite Force 2. With the commercial success of the first Elite Force, a sequel was bound to be greenlit. The unexpected part is that Raven wasn't brought back to develop it. Raven was hard at work on Jedi Knight 2 at the time, so I guess either Paramount or Activision weren't keen on the same company making both a Star Wars and a Star Trek FPS. In their place is Ritual Entertainment. Wait, Ritual? Really? You looked at the guys behind Sin and thought, this is the perfect studio for Star Trek. Well, okay. Raven may not have made the most interesting game, but they certainly respected the IP. Don't come crying to me when it turns out that Ritual doesn't give a damn about... Oh my god. The ancients foretold it, but I never believed them. A Star Trek FPS with genuinely great single player! I'm sorry for ever doubting you, Ritual. Released in June 2003 for Windows, and later that same year in November for Mac OS X, Elite Force 2 continues the adventures of the now Lieutenant Alex Monroe, starting with Voyager's grand finale before moving on to its own separate plot in the Alpha Quadrant. According to this interview I found on Den of Geek with project lead John Galloway, he had originally envisioned an M-rated affair centered around a group of Federation separatists who rammed a starship into Starfleet Academy. Nope, can't imagine why this idea got squashed. And as much as I would love shooting Maquis in the face over and over again, especially Michael Eddington...
And for what? To satisfy a personal vendetta?
You betrayed your uniform!
I have to side with the suits on this one. Though probably not for the same reasons. I just can't see a Star Trek game where you play as a Starfleet officer mostly fighting human enemies, because of course 99% of the Separatists would be human, being all that interesting. M-rating or not. That seems like a good way to wind up with a game that feels like a generic military shooter in Star Trek cosplay. And we were not lacking for generic military shooters back then. Instead, Lieutenant Monroe, sadly only in male form this time, in that same interview Galloway mentioned that the team wanted to keep the option for a male and female Monroe, but couldn't get upper management to agree to a feature that ran up the budget without adding to the length of the game. I'd argue that the choice offers a modicum of added replay value, but that's just me. The team was also forced to rush and crunch like mad throughout development, all the while dealing with constant demands from Activision. So at least some things never changed with AAA publishing. Add to all that yet more pressure from up top to create a game that reviewed well to prove that Star Trek games weren't as bad as people thought. Was that actually a perception at any point? Because sure, they ran the spectrum when it came to quality, but it's not as if there were no good Star Trek games that came before. Fuck's sake, this was a sequel to a Star Trek game that reviewed fantastically. Has Activision ever known what the hell they were doing? These are the kind of conditions that almost always lead to a rushed, broken mess that kills the developer responsible. Yet Ritual managed to rally and not simply produce a functional game, but one that improves on its predecessor in almost every way. They were rewarded for their hard work with good to great reviews across the board, and commercially, Activision deliberately didn't burn enough copies of Elite Force 2, all so they could weasel out of the final year of their licensing agreement with Paramount.
There is nothing about this whole scenario that doesn't make me so disgusted I want to violently vomit out my own internal organs.
Let's move on before I start ranting about how big publishers have always been bastards and that this is not a new problem in gaming. Elite Force 2's improvements start right away with the fact that it makes the choice the first game never made and opts to be a fun FPS first and a Star Trek game second. Several of the weapons, for instance, feel more like they belong to the Colonial Marines or the Mobile Infantry than Starfleet, to the point of now having to reload the compression rifle. This is the kind of break from canon that I don't mind too much, however, as it results in weapons that are more fun to use than many of the equivalents in Elite Force 1. Except for the Atrexian Arc Launcher. That one sucks. Among the returning weapons, we have the Phaser, which you'll only be using in emergencies, the Phaser Compression Rifle, a solid semi-auto rifle that's had its insta-kill sniper mode from the first game replaced with a slightly weaker blast, the iMod, somehow even more badass and satisfying to use than before, and still useful after you're done fighting the Borg, the Grenade Launcher, still exactly what it says on the tin, the Tetrion Gatling Gun, a slightly modified take on the Tetrion Pulse Disruptor that's still just as useful for clearing a room with a wall of bullets, and the Quantum Burst, an upgraded version of the Photon Burst with a more balanced damage output that replaces the homing torpedo alt-fire with one that allows you to guide the torpedo manually after launch. The new weapons are more in line with what you'd expect from a shooter at this point. We have the Enhanced Compression Rifle, a rapid-fire assault rifle with a grenade launcher alt-fire, then there's the one they labeled assault rifle, even though it's clearly a shotgun, which, like Sin's shotgun before it, is inconsistent in its damage output because of the wide spread, followed by the sniper rifle, the alt-fire of the first game's phaser rifle given its own spot in the list. It eats through ammo like crazy, but does great damage and can even be hip-fired in a pinch. The previously mentioned Atrexian Arc Launcher, a rapid-fire pistol that I only used when I started running low on phaser ammo. Its alt-fire is a cool idea, though. It fires a charge which sticks to the ground and explodes in a big shock of static when you fire another shot in that direction. Finally, we have a cameo from a weapon we first saw in Klingon Honor Guard, the Batleth. You aren't given many opportunities to use one, sadly, and this is probably the one time that Elite Force 2's lack of blood was a noticeable disappointment to me. There are three other weapons as well, but since two are tied into the story and a third one is tied to a level's secrets, they'll have to wait until the spoiler section. Yes, you heard me right. This time around, there are, in fact, secrets hidden throughout the levels. From the usual out-of-the-way ammo caches to extensive ones requiring you to memorize the correct access code in order to see a developer in-joke. The monkey is not amused indeed. It's as plain as the nose on my face that the boomer shooter spirit lives on in Elite Force 2. There are even these golden starships you can collect which unlock extra levels to play. Unfortunately, most of these levels can be finished in the blink of an eye. The big exception being this isometric arena level where you play as your Klingon buddy Korban, which kicked my ass left and right. With the rushed nature of Elite Force 2's development, though, I hardly have room to complain that they didn't add enough bonus material. As for the single-player campaign levels themselves, I quite like them. Despite the fact that Elite Force 2 is about as linear as its predecessor, I felt much less like I was tied to rails the whole way, and appreciated that I had to actively search for the way forward at times. The atmosphere in many of them is fantastic, too. My personal favorite being this early section where you're investigating the derelict USS Dallas. It borders on horror for a time as you work your way around the locked-down, powerless vessel which has been disabled by an unknown enemy. You know something's going to ambush you, but the level takes its time in building up the tension before the enemies finally come out in force. Those enemies, meanwhile, make my nods to Aliens and Starship Troopers very apt. These exomorphs, not to be confused with Xenomorph or the SSI game Entomorph, are highly adaptable, spacefaring, artificially created organic life forms capable of wiping out entire planets with their swarms. so they got a bit of Tyranid in their DNA as well. Definitely a lot of it on the visual side. Though I don't believe the Tyranids travel by butt rocket. Federation versus Xenobug Tyramorphs wasn't on my bucket list, but I'm cool with it. This was another result of the rushed production, as Ritual needed a simple enemy type that could be believably dumb, yet still dangerous if they overran you. Kudos to Mr. Galloway and his team for this. It was a clever way to get around an obvious development hurdle instead of attempting to brute force a more complicated type of enemy. And what's this? Is this a tricorder I see? I don't believe it. I finally get to use a tricorder outside of Virtual Voyager. There's a fair few uses for it too. Aside from enabling different vision modes that show you structural weaknesses or gas sources, you'll use the tricorder to unlock certain doors and consoles. Some even require you to complete a simple pipe or sine modulation puzzle. This is exactly what I was talking about with providing even the barest of gameplay deviations in Elite Force 1. Both of these games come from that point in gaming where people were expecting a bit extra from their shooters beyond giving them arenas of enemies to butcher, especially with a license like Star Trek with its sci-fi gadgetry and other assorted rigmarole. But I think what impresses me the most, considering the hellish development cycle, is how damn good this game looks. This is from 2003 on the id Tech 3 engine, the very same engine that powered the first Elite Force only 3 years prior. I think the only better looking game on this engine is 2004's Everything or Nothing. Soon, my sweet. As soon as I figure out what's up with the Xbox this time. Characters look great, environments look great, weapons look great. It all just looks, well, great. The jankiest part of it all being the mouth movement and dialogue, and that's just something I expect from most PC games prior to Half-Life 2. On top of that, while fun gameplay for sure feels like a priority over absolute adherence to Star Trek lore, that doesn't mean Ritual didn't do a good job with keeping the presentation nice and Trekkie. Exploring the Enterprise-E is as cool, actually a bit cooler for me if I'm being honest, as exploring Voyager. This time with a few moments of actual dialogue with crew members and even a handful of dialogue options. In addition, Zach Bellica, whose excellent soundtrack for Sin I completely failed to mention in my video because I'm incompetent, put on his usual magic with a pulse-pounding score that nevertheless retains faithful nods to the typical orchestral arrangements of Star Trek. Though I will acknowledge that there are some definite moments where you're reminded that this is the same studio responsible for Sin and Heavy Metal Fact 2. Really? Ritual made this? I never would have guessed.
Nice boobies!
While I compared the plot of the first Elite Force to an average episode of 90s Star Trek, I'd say that Elite Force 2's plot is closer to that of the movies. Not on the level of the best ones, but certainly leagues better than Drek like Star Trek 5.
Row, row your boat.
Row, row, row your boat. I love row. Do you know row, 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 row your boat?
That song did not come up in my research, Captain.
Following one final middle finger to the Borg, complete with actual boss fight, the Hazard team make their way home with the rest of the Voyager crew, only to be told, "Holy eyebrows, Batman!"
Those eyebrows.
Only to be told that Starfleet is disbanding the Hazard team, as they have no need for such teams in the Alpha Quadrant. The only memorable members of Hazard team are split up, with Monroe being assigned to teach small group tactics at Starfleet Academy. But not before I picked the absolute wrong thing to say to my sort of girlfriend, Telsia.
I won't let you throw away your career for me.
You mean you won't throw away your career for me?
We pick up 2 years later where you and Corban are fighting Romulans inside of a Klingon base. So, holodeck simulation? Holodeck simulation. Outside the simulation, you're greeted by Commander Eyebrows and... Captain Picard! No, bad mic. No fanboying. Picard expresses interest in the Hazard team and wants Monroe to put a new team together for a trial run on the Enterprise-E. This feels extremely out of character for Picard to me. He seems like the last Starfleet captain who would ever sign off on a militaristic concept like the Hazard team.
We're out here to explore. To make contact with other life forms. Establish peaceful relations, but not to interfere. And absolutely not to destroy.
I think it would have been cooler if he'd played a more skeptical, possibly even antagonistic role to Monroe. Both men want the best for Starfleet, but their experiences and personal ethics put them at odds over how to accomplish that.
The Doctor didn't spend 7 years in the Delta Quadrant for you folks to question his agency! He's got rights!
If this were meant to be canon in any way, I could see this potentially being a more annoying issue. But seeing as how Elite Force 2 is clearly in its own universe, it doesn't detract from the rest of the game. Patrick Stewart is fantastic like always, and Picard feels much more in character for the rest of the game. Besides, if Picard acting somewhat out of character was enough to ruin things for me, his reaction to the Borg in First Contact contradicting how he acted towards the Borg in later seasons of Next Generation would have ruined that movie for me. In my opinion, canon can be bent so long as it serves an interesting story. You just have to keep in mind that this can be risky to do so, as it can amplify every problem with a weaker story tenfold. Now let's head back to Elite Force 2. With a new lease on life, the Hazard team is reunited, or at least the Hazard team members shown in the prologue, as well as Ensign Jarrett, the medic who played a noticeable role in, like, two missions in the first game. But we didn't want this team to be a total sausage fest with Telsia still assigned to another ship. Plus the new additions of Ensign Corban, Stockman, and Deadmeat. Oh, and Tuvok is here too, since Michael Dorn turned them down. Mr. Worf is on leave. Yes, that's it. Pay no attention to Corban's We Have Worf at Home design. In fact, the only other TNG actor to return is Dwight Schultz as Lieutenant Barclay. Before there's any time to settle into your new digs, the Enterprise picks up a distress signal from the USS Dallas in Atrexian space. The Atrexians are a species created for this game whom we'll be seeing soon enough. For now, it's the new Hazard team's first mission aboard the Dallas. Hang on, what was the name of the ship Telsia got reassigned to?
The Dallas is a good ship.
Well, that's convenient. Provided she's still alive. As I said earlier, the Dallas is a fantastic level thick with atmosphere. While the exomorphs themselves aren't all that scary, what with their explosive fart propulsion system, the build to their first attack and the death of Ensign Deadmeat is damn near perfect. Executing the build-up and payoff properly like this is the difference between homage and ripoff in my mind. You and the remainder of your team make your way through the derelict ship towards the bridge, fending off exomorph ambushes all the while. Once at the bridge, the captain's final log indicates that a few crew members attempted a last-ditch effort to hide themselves within the transporter's pattern buffer until rescue arrived. Yay! My sorta ex-girlfriend is one of the survivors!
You're late, Monroe.
I think they're back to normal already.
Oof. That first conversation with the ex after years apart is always awkward. I assume. I've never even held hands with a woman. Turns out that obsessing over old video games and knowing an enormous amount of useless pro wrestling trivia doesn't make you a quintessential stud muffin. Who knew? There's little time to celebrate, though, as the nearby Atrexian space station is now under exomorph attack. Time to save the day again and— GAH! Do we have to save the aliens with the eye sphincters? Stop blinking, dammit!
Well, he looks at me, and I look at him, and he looks at me, and I look at him, and he looks at me, and I look at him!
Fine, I'll help them. They better not turn out to be, like, blatantly repressing another species whom they use as slave labor.
Idril?
A backward race. We've been assisting them for centuries.
We've given the Idril the gifts of written language and the warp drive.
But the Separatists are not grateful. They claim that many Atrexian systems are actually ancient Idril homeland.
They've created a delusional fiction in which they are an older race than we.
So, the Idril are blatantly being repressed and used as slave labor. Good to see that the Federation still refuses to give more than a cursory glance at a species before planning on bringing them into the fold. While on the Atrexian station, you run into another crew member of the Dallas, Ensign Gonzalez. Turns out that he and other non-essential personnel were evacuated to the station before the Dallas became completely inoperable and have been helping where they can since the attack on the station began. Also, Gonzalez is played by Raymond Cruz, who played Tuco Salamanca on Breaking Bad. I've never actually seen Breaking Bad, nor do I really care all that much to, but my buddy Aiden would have killed me if I didn't acknowledge this connection. After saving the Atrexian station, the Enterprise tracks the impulse drive of one of the fleeing exomorphs to an Idril dig site on a nearby planet. And I'm gonna go ahead and put the spoiler warning up here. If you don't want the rest of the plot spoiled for you, skip ahead to my final thoughts here. Here we have another highlight level where we get to do a little bit of tomb raiding on the way to rescuing an Idril science team trapped deep in the ruins. I'm a big fan of levels that task me with navigating ancient ruins and surviving through numerous traps. This segment is no exception. Not to mention that it appears to put a massive dent in the Atrexian claim that the Idril are a primitive race with no history. This place sure doesn't resemble the highly industrial architecture of the Atrexians. It's here that you'll find the one secret weapon in the game, the Idril Staff, which runs on the same ammo as the Arc Launcher and is twice as effective as that piece of shit. To acquire it, you'll have to jump on these tiles in the correct order shown here. It may be the least Star Trek armament in the whole game, but I highly recommend grabbing this baby as I found it to be one of the most versatile weapons in the whole game, with plenty of ammo for it scattered about. After fighting your way through the ruins, you finally rescue the scientists who... Oh my god. Oh. So, you're telling me that Ritual made this game, huh? Couldn't tell. Early 2000s. Did your horniness know no bounds? Miss Stripper Science here is Clea, played by anime dubbing mainstay Amanda Wynn Lee, using a sultrier version of her Rei Ayanami voice.
They chased us from the lab. We were safe, but we had no way to communicate with Krindo or the scientists on the surface. I was terrified, and then you were there.
God bless her, she does her best with this character, but I could never get past that ridiculous outfit. It shoots all the way past sexy and winds up in ludicrous territory. With Clea are Inigor and his son Krindo. I can't find anything officially stating who played Inigor, though Von Armstrong is listed in the credits and it sure sounds like him to me.
Quite so. Please save my son, if you can. I'm amazed you were able to make it this far.
After all we've been through, I'd rather hear the good news from you.
But Krindo is played by Robert O'Reilly, here to make up for Klingon Honor Guard's depressing lack of his hamtastic presence with a much bigger role here. The scientists explained that the Exomorphs were created in this place by the ancient Idril to serve as a free workforce. Why that entailed making them able to do things like chew through a Starfleet ship's hull, we'll never know. Showing the exact same lack of foresight as their ancestors, the scientists reactivated the facility and in no time flat, the Exomorphs turned on them. Naturally, Krindo thinks this is nothing more than a simple setback and is utterly incensed at the idea of turning the damn thing off and pretending this never happened. I'm sure, though, he'll handle things like a rational man of science and not go on a genocidal temper tantrum after being denied what he wants. Nor will he swear bloody vengeance when the woman he's extremely possessive of opts to stay on the Enterprise to help clean up their mess.
Do not allow her to stay, Picard.
Dr. Clear, you will be assisting the research team. Welcome to the Enterprise.
Thank you, Captain.
Picard out.
You'll regret this.
Incidentally, this is the start of a love triangle, allowing the player to choose between spending time with Telsia or Clea between missions. Seeing as how he went through hell in the Delta Quadrant with Telsia, it seemed like a dick move to have Monroe ignore her in favor of the chick he just met. I did play through a second time to compare, and while I think there's a bit more substance to Telsia's romance, both routes are really kind of... eh. Credit to Ritual for offering some form of choice for the player, but it's nothing special from a character or writing perspective. In no time flat, Krindo has unleashed the Exomorphs on an Atrexian planet while he and his buddies ambush the Enterprise. This level is a cool nod to an early level in the first game where you fend off the scavengers attacking Voyager. Except this time it ends in a really dull turret section. There's no time to chase after Krindo just yet, though. First up, we have to put a stop to the Exomorph attack planet-side. Not a whole lot to say about the next few levels. There's nothing wrong with them or anything, but nothing too plot-relevant happens until you catch up with Krindo, who's hiding out in another ancient Idril ruin. Or should I say, he catches you.
Ooh, I bruised my little piggy headbone!
But the imprisonment doesn't last long. One cutscene, in fact. Back on the Atrexian planet, you briefly ran into Inigor, who was trying his best to save people from his son's madness. Using this info, Monroe is able to convince Krindo to contact his father just in time for Inigor to be brutally killed by Exomorphs. Well, Krindo. If it isn't the consequences of your own actions. To my surprise, Krindo doesn't double down on his lunacy and at last realizes just how badly he's fucked up. Unfortunately, the Exomorphs have stopped responding to his commands. Again. It's almost like this technology was buried for a reason. All he can do is set the place to self-destruct and hand himself over to Starfleet. While he's being questioned by Picard and Monroe over what could have caused his control to be overridden again, Krendo admits to the existence of a master control facility. But according to him, the only ones who knew about it were him, his father, and the Ferengi Omag. Time to have a talk with the Ferengi. This station is another standout level. In order to get into the VIP room to speak with Omag in the first place, you have to win a cage fight with the bouncer. A brief chat with Omag goes nowhere, though it does reveal that Krendo was smart enough to give the Ferengi false coordinates, yet dumb enough to assume Omag wouldn't track the shuttle that he gave Krendo. Soon enough, Omag pulls a runner, and now you have to give chase through a hive of scum and villainy. Whoops, wrong franchise. Here's one of the toughest parts of the game, as these crooks are a lot more accurate than the Idril gorillas you were mowing down earlier, culminating in a pretty cool boss fight against the man in charge, Lurok, played by J.G. Hertzler, whom DS9 fans will know as the badass Klingon warrior Martok.
I look in their faces, and I know why they are here. They are Klingon warriors. They have answered the call of Kalis.
So have I.
Lie to yourself if you must, but not to me.
With Lurok defeated, it doesn't take long for the Enterprise to capture Omag, leading to one of my absolute favorite moments in the whole game. You have to trick Omag into revealing who he sold the info on the Master Control Facility to by quoting the correct Ferengi laws of acquisition. I don't think you can actually fail this outside of picking the obviously wrong choice at the end to accept Omag's bribe, but this stands out to me as the most Star Trek moment in either Elite Force game. A Starfleet officer outwitting the bad guy in a game of words rather than resorting to brute force. Definitely the one moment where Monroe feels like a real character and not a mere vessel for the player to inhabit.
But I won't tell you who he is unless you drop the charges and release me.
Very well.
On a planet of my choosing?
Of course not. We're not a shuttle service. We'll choose a planet convenient for us.
I accept the bargain. He is a captain in the Romulan Imperial Navy.
Romulans? What were you thinking?
I know. Romulans are usually terribly cheap.
Yeah, I should have figured the Romulans would be involved. Why else would they have picked Romulans as the enemies for that holodeck level near the start? Seriously though, Omag might be as dense as Krendo. And the Romulans access to a galactic-scale WMD in exchange for pinky swearing never to use it on Ferenginar.
Wrong! He agreed to never send them against a Ferengi planet. Ha! I win.
That's some Neville Chamberlain-level negotiating skills you got there, Omag. Looks like it's time to infiltrate a Romulan outpost. As you're in full Romulan disguise, you won't have access to your usual arsenal and are completely defenseless until about halfway through, when Starfleet's deep cover agent gives you a disruptor rifle. Pushing past my flashbacks to Klingon Honor Guard's disruptor rifle, I realized that this was actually a pretty decent weapon. It can be fired either in semi-auto or charged up for a more damaging shot, and slowly recharges itself rather than running off ammo pickups. Which is nice, because I couldn't figure out how to stealth my way through this part, or if it's even possible to do so. Gonzalez was supposed to be working with you on this mission, but wound up getting captured before you could link up. Once you've gotten the info you needed, you head over to rescue him, only to find out that the whole thing was a setup by the main bad guy, Commander Soldok. Soldok is played by horror icon and Star Trek regular Jeffrey Combs. If you need an actor to play a mentally unstable villain with delusions of grandeur, there are few better at it than Jeffrey Combs.
You must be Commander Soldok.
This frozen hellhole is your new home, Lieutenant. Until we gain all your knowledge about speeding up the exomorph creation process, we can learn it politely or painfully, but we will.
He also played the best version of Ratchet, hands down. Soldok is a member of an extremist faction within the Romulan Empire known as the Empty Crown, who believe that the aggressive, hyper-expansionist Empire isn't aggressive or hyper-expansionist enough. His plan is to use Starfleet's infiltration of one of the most secure black sites the Romulans have to convince the Senate of the need for an even stronger military, likely in the hopes of setting the stage for a coup. Which is why he had many of the base's defenses covertly disabled, and ordered his triple agent to aid you until the trap was sprung. Thankfully, being an appropriately dramatic villain, he takes the time to monologue a good chunk of his plan to Monroe and Gonzalez, and let it slip that he's holding the real coordinates to the Master Control Facility.
Sir, I strongly recommend...
Silence! We've jammed their transporters. They cannot leave. But I suppose it's best not to reveal the real location.
The damage is done, though, and Gonzalez bravely sacrifices himself to give Monroe the window to snatch the coordinates from Soldok and have the Enterprise beam him up. R.I.P., Ensign Gonzalez. I never stopped assuming you were gonna turn out to be evil.
You took my hand, you showed me how, you promised me you'd be around.
Okay, let's avenge the loyal man whom I never trusted and finish this once and for all. The first part here is a pretty damn ambitious set piece, with the Hazard team making a frontal assault on the Master Control Facility which Soldok has had fortified to hell and back. Teammates go down, multiple boss exomorphs make their return, you get this Romulan BFG that I avoided using because it's a massive ammo drain, and even the Enterprise itself gets in on the action with the ability to call in an orbital strike with her tricorder, climaxing with a fight against... Okay, now this is getting silly. Whoa, Nelly! He does a lot of damage for something so ridiculous looking. Stupid jetpack exomorph aside, it's all suitably epic. Then you do it all over again indoors, with even more boss exomorphs, and a much more bullshit close quarters fight with Captain Splash damage here. To my relief, the fight with Soldok is much better. You have to fend off these spider exomorphs and dodge Soldok's disruptor blast while waiting for an opportunity to snipe him in the dick. It's not over once he's defeated though, no. With his final breath, Soldok unleashes the true controller of the exomorphs, the Archaeopendra. Wait, is that motherfucking Tony J? I don't know whether to be thrilled at fighting Soul Reaver's Elder God, or annoyed that I was denied dialogue between him and Jeffrey Combs.
Both. Both is good.
This fight is basically a second phase to the fight with Soldok. You'll continue to fend off these same spider exomorphs while waiting for the Archaeopendra to surface from the lava and unload everything you've got on him. Once that's done, all that's left is to watch the last cutscene, get your Mac on with the girl you spent the most time with, and then the credits roll. While I enjoyed the story for the most part, I can't help but feel like the Atrexian's role in all of this gets brushed under the rug. You'd think that their burying of Idril history, in addition to the reveal I forgot to mention, that their ancestors enslaved the Idril as punishment for the last time the exomorphs were unleashed, would have a more central role in the plot. At the very least, I feel there should have been an Atrexian antagonist at some point along the way. Yet all the tension between them and the Idril is barely a factor at all in the plot, outside of providing an explanation as to why Krindo is so aggro. Heh, that almost rhymed. So, that was Star Trek Elite Force 2. I feel like the fact that I had about as much to say about it as the other two combined makes it clear how much I enjoyed my time with it. Ritual Entertainment were given a Herculean task, and despite every roadblock, delivered with a sequel that improves on its predecessor in every way it needed to. Better, more open level design, massively improved gameplay with greater variety, a suitably action-packed, if unintentionally hilarious at times, story, and it does this all while retaining a healthy level of respect for the Star Trek license. If I had to pick any serious negatives, I can see the exomorph swarms feeling too repetitive for some. There's also some ill-fitting ritualisms, such as Clea's nonsensical outfit. However, those downsides aren't enough for me to not regard Elite Force 2 as one of the most fun and engaging Star Trek games. It's only through Activision's disgusting malice that it failed at market, and the fact that Ritual were the ones to pay the price for this makes it all the more sickening. Do yourself a favor and pick this up on GOG sometime. Even if you're not all that big on Star Trek, I think this is worth the $10. Phew. Three games in one video. So much for my attempt to focus on shorter videos for a time. For anyone wanting an official ranking, well, if I'm rating on overall design quality, it neatly goes in release order with Klingon Honor Guard in third, Elite Force in second, and Elite Force 2 in first. In terms of which I feel the most faithful to the source material, Elite Force is far and away in first place. But if we're talking about which ones I had the most fun with, then Elite Force is in third, behind Klingon Honor Guard, and then Elite Force 2 holding a strong lead over both. Man, I am gonna get crucified for that take. But if I'm just doing these videos to validate other people's opinions, then what's the point? Anyways, that's it for these games. If you'd like to see me do more Star Trek games, let me know, and I'll see you next time.